Thank you, and thank you for this kind introduction, and thank you for the invitation to come here as well as to Justin. That's the first note. The second note is that it's very appropriate that we talk about high-TC squids in Sweden, because a Swedish chemist, Carl Arrhenius, found a mineral sample in Ytterby, which is in the Stockholm archipelago. And this sample contained an oxide of a new element, which was identified by a Finnish chemist, Johan Karolin, in the Royal Academy in Turku, which then became University of Helsinki. And this oxide was an oxide of element yttrium. So that's by the, where the Y in the YBCO comes from. So today I am going to, upon Daniel's request, talk about a little bit about MEG and EEG in general, and then about the evolution of MEG technology, and then give you a status report of the baby MEG system in Boston and come to some conclusions. So first about MEG and EEG in multimodal imaging. So in some sense, our goal when we measure the brain non-invasively from outside the head is to do what is shown here on the inflated cortical surface to estimate what the time course of the electrical current distribution, the neural activity, is in the brain. In this case, this result has been obtained by using MEG and anatomical MRI together, so that we have constrained the locations of the sources to the cortical mantle and then estimated the currents in the brain. EEG can also help in this estimation, because it provides, as we will see later, a little bit different view of the same currents in the brain. fMRI, on the other hand, is related not to the currents directly, but to the associated hemodynamic activity, and therefore it's important to realize that it's slow, but it's not only slow, but it's not measuring the same thing as MEG. Oops. MEG and EEG. But it's measuring the hemodynamic signals. And the same signals are also measured by near-infrared spectroscopy from a limited area in the brain, typically. And this optical method is useful, actually, in infants, because the infant skull is more transparent than our skulls. And MEG and EEG measure the electric potentials and the magnetic field generated by neural currents, which are here indicated by this red arrow, which I call the primary current, and from this primary current follows the electric potential distribution, which is measured on the scalp, and also these thin lines indicating the volume currents which followed electrical potential differences in a conducting medium. And this primary current and the volume currents in general together generate the magnetic field, but it turns out that in the case of the head, it's actually very easy to tell what the magnetic field is from the primary current, starting from the primary current, whereas the EEG is more complicated to calculate, because the EEG is a local measurement of the potential, whereas MEG is an integrated measure of all currents. Both MEG and EEG have what I would say reasonable spatial resolution, which is like this. It's a rule of thumb. The spatial resolution is the width of the thumb. And both of these are real-time measures of brain activity, and they can be used, for example, to infer connectivity in different frequency ranges of the activity in the brain. So the benefits are that they are indeed electrophysiological measures of brain activity, which we are interested in. And especially in MEG will have a very friendly measurement environment. It's silent, and you don't have to fix any electrodes on the head. And this is important not only in infants, but also in patient groups like patients suffering from psychiatric diseases, these diseases who don't easily tolerate a lot of electrodes on their head. And also the placement of the electrodes is time consuming. And they combine precise timing with reasonable spatial resolution and connectivity measures. And importantly, they tell about the spectral content of the signals. And also, rather than measuring indirectly these relative hemodynamic changes, MEG and EEG measure physical quantity, the electric current. And therefore, they can directly tell the amplitude of something which we can also assess by invasive measurements in the brain. And this gives us the possibility to assess the mechanisms of the signals we observe and also give possibilities for physiological interpretation much more easily than the hemodynamic signals. Talking about the frequency content of the signals, we already heard about the rhythmic activity in the brain, alpha and beta range, 10 and 20 Hz activity, but these different rhythms also have a significance in terms of connectivity as shown in this Robert Ostenveld slide, so that the higher frequency signals relate to local connectivity in the brain, 10 and 7 Hz alpha and theta band signals more to connections between subcortical structures and the cortex, and then 20 Hz signals across the cortex. What I mean about this possibility of accessing the mechanisms is something like this. With Stephanie Jones, we have developed in Boston biophysical models which are able to actually estimate what kind of currents would arise in an assembly of thousands of cells in certain conditions and assuming certain connections between the cells. And then from this model we can try to understand what is the reason for some changes, for example, in evoked responses or rhythmic activity that we observe in MEG. Of course, when we make this kind of bottom-up model, it may be wrong. It just accidentally matches. But then what Stephanie has done with Chris Moore at Brown University is to make similar measurements, in this case somatosensory measurements, in rats. And in rats you can actually measure these currents physically from the brain, and you can assess whether the predictions of the model are correct in the brain. And therefore, by using this combination, you gain more confidence for the model being correct also in humans. Now, when we try to understand MEG and EEG, it's important to understand how these signals are generated. That is the forward model. And if you look around, the most straightforward approximation for the head is to assume that it's a sphere-like in this subject. And if you fit the sphere model to this subject, it's a good fit. It would be much nicer if we wouldn't have to take into account all the different layers as here in the left, which are the scalp and the skull and the brain, and possibly also white matter, but rather to use a homogeneous model. And there's a happy consequence of basic physics that the magnetic field outside this spherical symmetric conductor stays the same independent of the conductivity structure. So we need to know much less about the structure of the head for MEG interpretation than for EEG interpretation, which is crucially dependent on the conductivities because it measures the potentials on the scalp and is affected even by local conductivity changes. Now, if we go to a more complicated boundary element model of the head, the same kind of benefit remains. On the left, we have a three-compartment model of the head, which contains the brain, the skull, and the scalp. And on the right, the simple model where we have assumed that the skull is not only a poor conductor of electricity, but also, in fact, an insulator. And it turns out that even in this case, the MEG is almost the same, whereas EEG is drastically different. So for MEG modeling, we need to know less about the structure of the head. And this has been confirmed not only theoretically but also by experiments later on. Now, one consequence of this layered structure which affects EEG is that the EEG is smeared, it's spread out. Here we have the magnetic field measured on the right side of the head as a response to an auditory stimulus, and on the right the electric potential. You notice that the patterns are orthogonal to each other basically because of the curl in the Maxwell's equations, which was built into full students. And it's obvious that if you would be able to make these MEG measurements right on the scalp, this pattern would be much tighter, and I will talk about that more later. Another consequence of this almost spherical head is that we get different kind of sensitivity to currents on the cortex. And here are again pyramidal cells on the cortex which are aligned so that these apical dendrites are normal to the cortex, and independent of whether synaptic input is on the superficial layers or near the stroma, this geometrical arrangement of the cells guides the current to be normal to the cortex. Now it turns out that in the sphere model it is so that radial current in the sphere produces no magnetic field. This follows from the spherical symmetry. And from this then it follows that if here is a piece of cortex folded like this on the gyri, the currents are radial and therefore there's no MEG from these areas, whereas there is strong EEG, whereas when you go to the fissures you see both MEG and EEG. And here is what it looks like on the whole cortex. So this plot is on an inflated cortical surface where the folds have been opened, and I have placed at each location of the cortex a current dipole and then calculate on the left the amplitude of MEG and on the right the amplitude of EEG as measured by magnetometers, so electrodes in the scalp, for each current dipole on the cortex. And let's take a close up from here. So this is actually the just a minute. This here is the rolandic fissure or central sulcus where the somatosensory and motor cortices are located. And indeed, at the top of this gyrus in front of the sulcus here, MEG is zero because the currents are radial. And when you go off there to the side so that the currents turn, the signals are very strong, and then they go down, and they go very much down at the bottom of the sulcus, where the currents are again radial. And now, if you look at EEG, EEG is strongest at the gyrus here, where the currents are radial, because the radial currents are so close to the EEG electrodes, whereas the signal goes down constantly when you go down to the sulcus. This means that if you try to measure something in the sulcus in EEG and there's simultaneous background brain activity, the signal-to-noise ratio of EEG can be worse than in MEG, and this we have indeed observed in several epileptic patients who have epileptic spikes originating from the sulcus, and you sometimes cannot see them at all in EEG, whereas you can see them very clearly in MEG, and this is because of the background activity. And we have sometimes found that after we average several of these spikes, then we see them also in EEG, but you couldn't do the averaging without detecting them first. Then if we turn to the other side of the hemisphere, that is on the medial surface, which is on the surface in the middle of the brain, we see that MEG dies down much more quickly from the surface than EEG, and therefore EEG has a benefit in looking on the deeper areas in the brain. So MEG is less than EEG, but that's not at all often bad because you filter automatically out these radial currents which are close. On the other hand, from this picture you get the conclusion that it would be best to measure both at the same time. Now, about the evolution of MEG technology. So the first real-time MEG was measured in 1971 by David Cohen at MIT. And here you see eyes open situation and eyes closed situation and very clear algorithm. And the reason why this was measured at that time is of course that the strength of this field is only 10 to minus 8 Gauss, which means basically that 100 million times smaller than the Earth's magnetic field. And indeed, this was made possible by the invention of the SQUID. The SQUID noise is shown here, which can be as low as 1 femtotesla per square root of Hertz. Then there is ultimately a limit from the thermal noise in the body, which is estimated to be 10 times smaller. So 100 attotesla per square root of Hertz. And the sizes of different signals from the body are shown here. The heart signal, the signals from the eyes and the evoked responses to stimuli are shown on this scale. So the MEG signals are of the order of hundreds of femtoteslas. And here are David Cohen and Jim Zimmerman, who invented the SQUID, and Ed Erlsak from the Office of Naval Research in front of David's almost spherical shielded room. And there's a subject inside with the first MEG system in front of her. And just as a note, David is still around. I share an office with him at MGH. And likes to do DC measurements because those are his initials also. And he made the first MEG measurements and many pioneering experiments and modeling studies. And he also actually introduced the double D coils, the planar gradiometers, which are now used in the vector view / triox system, which we heard about earlier with its 306 sensors. And in each of the sensor elements, you measure the horizontal or the vertical derivative of the normal component of the magnetic field or the field itself with the magnetometer. And actually, David had exactly this kind of device, one of these sensors basically made in wire-wound technology early on. Then tomorrow we will hear about the important step of going from the measurements to the sources. And this we call source estimation or the solution of the inverse problem. And the task is to determine from the measured magnetic field pattern what the estimated current in the brain is, the likely current in the brain is. And Alex will talk about this in length, but I will just mention that this problem is very well known to be an ill-posed problem, which means that many different current distributions can potentially explain the data. But even more importantly, and certainly more importantly from today's point of view, is that the solution may be sensitive to noise that is unstable. So one or the other is enough to render a problem ill-posed. And how we can mitigate this is we can avoid ambiguity by incorporating constraints. For example, we can decide that it's likely that the current distribution is focal, that is more like a current dipole or diffuse spread out in the brain, and we can restrict the location and orientations of the current to the cortex because the cortex is the main source of MEG and EEG. And then we can use fMRI also in some cases to determine which are the most likely active sites in the brain. I must emphasize though that the ambiguous doesn't mean the same as arbitrary. So this is somehow stuck into people's minds that since something is ambiguous, it's totally arbitrary. But it's not so. Even different models produce very similar results. And to mitigate the second factor in the ill-posedness, we can try to increase the SNR and increase the spatial information available in the signals by bringing the sensors closer to the sources. So it is not so that some kind of miracle happens stepwise when we go to the currents in the brain that we suddenly know everything uniquely. It's a continuum. When if we try to measure what happens in our brains in Stockholm, it's totally impossible. Now it's possible to measure it very accurately, in fact, with the present lowTc systems at the distance of 2 centimeters. If we can reduce this distance from the scalp to zero, things improve. And this is shown here. So we have simulated three kinds of systems. We have simulated a hypothetical 500-channel system in which the sensors are on the scalp. Then here's the vector view, and you really see how far the sensors are. It's almost scary. It's almost a miracle that you can accurately determine the locations of the sources from such a distance. And then one would, of course, hope that EEG would be as good. But now remember that EEG is smeared. So on the scalp, the MEG pattern is much more focal than the EEG pattern, and therefore, if we again now plot the dipole localization accuracy for each source on the cortex, we see that this first arrangement is best. So the color scale is such that blue is bad and red is good. Red is bad and blue is good. Sorry. And you see clearly that there's quite a lot of red in this vector view picture, and the amount of red decreases significantly. But the EEG is still much worse than the hypothetical on-scalp MEG. And now we can see it even better if we plot the localization error as a function of the amplitude of the current on the cortex at different locations in the brain. Here are two examples. This is in the frontal lobe, and this is in the somatosensory cortex. And in green we have the vector view. In blue we have the high density EEG on the scalp, and in red the 500 channel MEG system, which I already call the diamond MEG system for reasons which are will become obvious later. And you can see that the localization accuracy is much better for this 500-channel MEG system on the scalp, and SNR is also improved a lot when you use the scalp measurements. The range of the currents up to 1 nanometer per square millimeter of cortex comes from a recent paper by Yoshio Okada, where he argues that there's kind of a rule of thumb current density on the cortex, which applies even across species and across preparations as different as the human cortex and the turtle cerebellum. But this is just a side note. Now, another way to look at this is to look at the field amplitudes, which is shown up here, and on the other hand, how much spread we have in the image of a point source when we use MEG to determine its distribution. And this is a paper from on the HPM conference in 2013, and you see that the sensitivity, that is the SNR, improves about a factor of 2.5 when you average all over the cortex. So this is the histogram of the improvements across the cortex. The reason that there's less improvement sometimes is that for the deeper areas of the cortex, this distance difference doesn't make such a big difference to the SNR, but for the closer by areas it does a lot. And point spread function, that is the size of the image of a point source, is improved by, on the average, maybe a factor of 4 if we eyeball this distribution here. Now, we have heard a lot about high-TC squids, and so finally they have reached the sensitivity. And as we heard, there wasn't really a revolution, but a continuum of development. But still, these sensors need cryosense, and there are at least two other sensor technologies that are becoming viable. And both of these are room temperature sensors. One of them is the atomic magnetometer, which uses vapor so that it is actually hot. It's not even room temperature, but it's warmer than room temperature. And another one is what we call now quantum diamond sensors. That's a diamond lattice with vacancies and nitrogen impurities, and there are some electron energy levels which are affected by the magnetic field, and they can be read out with light and excited by light. And we have made a noise estimate with Ron Walsport from the Harvard Physics Department that you could even reach noise which is below 1 femtotesla per square root of hertz if we can make such a sensor with volume greater than 1 cubic millimeter. But these macroscopic sensors have not yet been made, and this is exactly what we have applied funding for. And with this quantum diamond sensors, you could imagine to have an on-scalp MEG device. For example, you could produce a helmet with a 3D printer matching your head. You put the helmet in, and then you snap the sensors on like electrodes. They hang on an optic fiber, and then you could always measure from the same position from a given subject. And then the subject could also move his head. But that is a little bit of a challenge, because even in the magnetic shielded room, there are field gradients within the room, and when the head moves in this field gradient, there will be disturbances, but this could be avoided by having another stationary system which measures the field distribution far away from the head, and then you could compensate. And now it turns out that these quantum diamond sensors don't care about high magnetic fields. They have been operated in fields of teslas. This would potentially mean that you could build a system for combined MEG ephemera, high field ephemera, not ultra low field ephemera, and also for TMS. But this is, of course, a dream at the moment, because we don't have the sensors. And second, there would be a significant challenge in getting rid of the noise in the ephemera. And then you could have two of these devices in the same room and, for example, measure these two people playing the piano at the same time. And then you indeed could make this array of magnetrodes which would snap on in a plastic holder. So much about development. So my dream would be have a room temperature 500 channel MEG system. Somehow on the way there, we have developed in Boston an infant MEG system which is called the baby MEG. And the reason for this is that if you put the baby inside the vector view or triaxis, the baby's head covers only... Oops. Introduction. This happens sometimes on the Mac too, that it wants to do something strange. What happened? There. So the baby's head covers only a part, part of the sensor array. So actually in this case we have only like 30, 40 sensors on the head, and we can cover only one hemisphere or part of it even. But still we can measure, for example, somatosensory responses as shown here, both during active and quiet sleep. And actually then, once we can do this, we can see that the somatosensory responses in the newborn are quite different from those in the adults, and of course it would be intriguing to know why this happens. What is happening in the brain to cause this development. And Yoshi Okada actually built in Albuquerque first a smaller baby MEG system shown here. It's like a saucer-sized system with 74 sensors in a dense array. And these sensors are pretty close to the scalp. They are half the distance from the vector view, and therefore you can measure somatosensory responses with only a few averages as shown here, four averages. And the system is again shown here. Here is the little cup and bed, and here are some individual somatosensory responses measured from this system. So this was very encouraging that you could measure these single epoch data so clearly when you have the sensors close by. And therefore we applied funding from NSF together with Ellen Grant and Yoshio Okada and built this baby MEG system. So this here is not the Neuromag phantom you normally know, but this is a baby phantom. It's about this size. So this gives you an idea that the helmet is smaller. And inside this device there's a lowTc SQUID system which looks like this. So there are 275 primary magnetometers or inner layer magnetometers shown here in red, which are about 7 millimeters from the outside, so pretty close. And then there's an array of triple direction magnetometers for compensation further away, and there's even a third layer third layer of sensors for enabling more compensation schemes. There's one particular feature of the system that there's a lot of aluminum inside the system, and that causes this elevation of noise, but that can be pretty easily removed by simple linear projection. Now these noise levels are not up to date. They got maybe this inner layer noise to the half, because it turned out that a lot of this noise was dependent on the digitization noise in the acquisition system, which we could reduce once we got the external active shielding in the room working correctly, so that we could increase the gain of the acquisition of the electronics. And so now the noise levels are better, so that this may be about 7 femtoteslas per square root of hertz for the inner layer sensors. Unfortunately, I don't have yet baby data to show, because there are some administrative hurdles to be allowed to put babies into this device. And now if we make similar plots between the vector view and baby MEG in the localization accuracy, we again see that there is a huge improvement in the localization accuracy due to the proximity of the sensors. We have also developed acquisition software for this system, which is in principle and also in practice device independent, so that it can be used with multiple MEG systems. So you need to just write the connector piece to the device, and then you can use the same acquisition system. And an important aspect of this software is that it's geared towards doing real-time analysis, so that you could see during the experiment when you do somatosensory stimulation on the cortical surface where the activity occurs as a function of time. And this, there are a few steps to be accomplished to make this possible. And one of them is that, of course, you need to attenuate the noise in the data online, and then you need to determine the head position. And once you have the structural MRI information, you need to compute the gain matrix, and you need to update somehow this gain matrix on the fly during the experiment. But this can be done so that you compute the signals in a dense enough grid covering all the putative head positions, and then you can do it. But anyhow, this is our vision, that we could ultimately, using this device, thanks to the good signal-to-noise ratio, calculate source estimates and in some cases even some connectivity estimates during the experiment. So, summarizing, it's important to get close to the sources, because that basically mitigates the ill-posedness of the inverse problem and makes it easier to estimate the sources in the brain accurately. And there are several new sensor technologies which will enable better SNR spatial resolution and also innovative combinations of methods and MEG system designs. And it seems that indeed room temperature sensors are even feasible, and that would simplify the construction of the systems significantly. And finally, whole head infant MEG systems are coming online, and it will be interesting to see what we can do, if and when we can actually analyze the data during the experiments. And here's the BabyMEG now. This is still a doll, but in a couple of weeks, so hopefully it will be a real baby, and we will see what happens. And since a lot of this work relates to the BabyMEG, I have listed here the BabyMEG team in Boston as contributors. And thank you, and time for questions.